I'm Derek Day, and this is Rick. And we'll be going over this college subsystem. So our general requirements here are that the power subsystem will supply a continuous electric power to any subsystem that requires it during the mission life. The subsystem should be able to manage regulate and distribute this power. Also needs to store power for peak demand when we'll be using more than the dose. And needs to be able to produce an average of 1 watt. And the power system also shall remain powered off from turnover 2 to 20, followed by a third of the delay. Those are required measurements.
Okay, so here's the diagram showing where we have our hardware. So we have 4 pumpkin solar panels, which line the outside, and the power stack. There will be a solar panel in front. It's just hidden so you can see. And there's a block diagram, a very basic block diagram of the car. And this is our equipment. So we have a client space EPS, and it'll do power regulation and distribution. It's 10 individually controlled lines, so you can turn the line off. And it does have some radiation tolerance. We also have a device base, 10 watt-hour battery. It has an integrated battery heater, and it has protection features for like over discharge or short circuits, so prevent the battery from doing bad things. And we have the pump and solar panels, 2 watts per day.
It looks like we don't have the entirely updated version of this slide. So
here, you have this slide.
One of the last 4. Talks about each panel has 2 cells that are meant for this one. It happens. It's okay. So, as ADCS explained, we have a semi-uncontrolled spin on the x-axis, and that will have some effects on our power production. So, massive volume, as I explained, massive volume is not allowed in an energy control system, and so our power loop depends a lot on how fast we're spinning. What our current position is at the orbit of convective insulation. So this will be our problem with production. So this is some basic numbers that we have for power specification. So our average generation should be about 1.1 watts in sunlight. So our power load is about 0.9 watts, so we should be power positive with some of the battery and solar panel degradation. And our maximum depth of discharge occurs during data downlink. However, it's low enough that we shouldn't do any significant damage to the battery. We have a 10% margin pass for the EPS system. This is a slightly more comprehensive set of numbers for the power distribution. I'm just using a basic numbers for all of different systems, but we'll be using duty cycles, so not all of them will be at the same time. So here, the deadline average power is about 30 watts. With a 10% margin, we're still under a 1.1 So I've budgeted 1.1 watts.
So that's what you're comparing the 1.1 to.
Yeah.
I see the halo.
So your computer is a Raspberry Pi, which also controls the there's a it's only on when we're taking pictures.
So it's on all the time when you're taking pictures?
Yes. However, we don't have to use cameras on another payload. I think those are the more detailed ones.
Well, then we just have to recalibrate. Is that a requirement?
So, since we're using an industrial item, it does have some calibration fluctuations in research, so we're just using this to try to help remove those.
So this isn't the calibrator, so it's causing you to be power limited to one picture each day?
So, also part of those limitations is we don't have a ground station every 100 times a day, and so we don't let that solve so many power, so many pictures you can download. So for
DL, you have tons of storage.
Yeah, I need a lot of data lines. So you can take a lot of pictures and put them down.
Yeah, the data gathering is also the packages that we have to regulate.
When I said to go for about a picture, basically once sea surface temperature and one cloud top temperature every 2 days, I set it as a relatively conservative goal.
I understand that, but yeah. my question that I asked at the beginning of the presentation an hour and a half ago was, what's the bottleneck? And I still haven't gotten an answer. So let's see if by the end of the presentation we can figure out what's holding it up. I mean, I'd like to know what's the maximum number of pictures you could take.
Okay.
Because, again, it comes back to what you said at the beginning. If there was a real science requirement driver here, he or she would have said, I want 100 pictures a day, or 1,000 pictures a day, and one of you guys would have said, well, that's not realistic, you can only have so many.
What is that number?
But you can't just say, the minimum is one, so all we're going to do is one. No, that's not right either. You need to say, what could you do?
I think the bottleneck is pretty sure between power and communications.
Well, communications, we decided early a couple of slides ago, was not a bottleneck.
Yeah,
they put
that on you.
So they said, at the time that I asked the question, they said, oh, it's power. So here we are at power, but it doesn't seem like it's power.
But,
so,
but the comm up there, I mean, it's the 2 watts, which is the same as a calibrator, and it's 9 times or 8 times the duty cycle, right?
Right. But they're assuming to transmit you for the 6 minutes, right? So they have a ton of data on that. So
then why is the duty cycle 8%?
8% of the work time. That's only 6 minutes.
Right, per hour. Yeah, but it's eight times the higher calibrator use.
It's much quicker. We only need the cameras on a payload. I don't remember the exact number. It's about a minute.
Well, let's continue. But I mean, it's just, I think that there's more here that you guys probably want to think about what it really is limiting the performance. You go through all this trouble. Build a satellite and launch it and operate it, and you're only getting a picture a day, that's very unsatisfying.
And what if it's a bad?
Right.
You want to have a bunch, of, you know, you.
What if somebody's thumb is in the.
Right. If you're taking, you want to get a bunch. You get one Google per day or whatever. So.
So, So as long as we're asking questions, you had a 1.1 watt, which you said was your budgeted amount. Okay.
So that's with about 40% margin.
Yeah, but does that really come from, you have a cube, it has multiple sides, it's in some expected type of orientations, and you know, that 1.1 watt is some estimate of how the attitude plays with the sun and you know, the efficiencies and your collecting area and everything else. So you actually run through those numbers?
So the on the data sheet provided by Pumpkin tells us that the optimum for the optimal power production from one panel is 2 watts, and our EPS system has about 80% efficiency from those panels, and then I'm putting about a 30 or 40% margin on top of that, which takes us down to about that.
Okay, so you picked a margin as opposed to calculating kind of your best estimate of what the attitude profile would be, right? Depends on the attitude profile, right? If you're shining full on this side or it's a quarter or whatever, right? And your total power use, the 1.1, or the total power generation, 1.1 watts, is kind of your orbit average history of how much sun is shining on it for whatever time it is shining, right? Which is not all the time because you're an eclipse.
Yeah.
And, some of your sides won't have solar cells on them, right? So you get little if that's pointing at the sun. So I was just wondering if you would. So I think what you did was you derated it by estimate, but you haven't actually run the numbers on what you think the attitude profile will be and what that means for power in the country.
Yeah, I've just used some hopefully conservative estimates on what we'll be looking at.
You want to check
those. Yeah,
to
go
and
make sure.
Because
you think it's conservative.
There are a couple of cases you wouldn't like, right?
We didn't really have the software to do it.
No, that's fair. It's just,
power
it would be the next step.
Yeah, so we're just using
it. Could, but just to start, but so the next step.
If it was long, if it was very long, it might be a problem. But it's not.
It's not very long.
If it's long, it might be a problem. So what I do is, on some of these slides here, if you can have a negotiation amongst the team, which one is the driver, maybe highlight that.
So
like
this
that
is sort of a pared down. I have a much larger spreadsheet,
yeah,
but I don't think I have it included in this presentation.
No, and there's a sort of an art or science or something that taking your spreadsheet and making it something that the reviewers can understand and give you best feedback on, right? So this is a great start, but I think we're just going to use other ways that...
At the moment, I'm just kind of using kind of the template from
Well, that's kind of why I'm pushing it toward having it integrated, what's the day in the life of, and you can see at the end of the day, are you power extra? You have some more to go take pictures?
So, done something sort of like that.
And then you can negotiate, right? So people can negotiate, teams can say, well, we don't really need to do this way, we can move things around. And it's normal, like this process is part of designing a satellite.
We've been doing it constantly for the week that we've been working on it.
You're in the funny situation of not having the PI telling you how much science they want. Like generally, you're gonna say what do you need to do, and they're gonna say what can you do. And you're gonna go, what do you need me to do? And you're gonna argue about that. So that's a whole other dimension of that you haven't had yet. But that's where those requests for more information come from. You can never give a scientist enough data. It's full.
If I'm correct, I think this was this specific CubeSat is supposed to be more of a technical demonstration than a purely scientific.
Don't take the comments as criticism.
Well, I'm just
suggestion. No.
Yeah, we're just.
There are two things in presentation style that I got to mention. First of all, there's white noise in this room. You guys have to speak up because we don't hear you and we're old. And the second of all, when people ask you questions, listen to the entire question before answering.
Yeah.
Okay. Don't be offensive. They're just suggestions. Okay. So I think you should take all these as put them in your file cabinet for the next time you do these presentations. Say, oh, you know, maybe I should highlight the, don't say why you didn't do it now, just say think about it for the next time.
Nobody's getting graded here, right?
Right.
You guys don't have to, nobody's getting graded. This isn't the final exam. This is, you know.
Okay, well, anyway, so here are the risks. So, the EPS gets shut down due to a drop of 6.2 volts. The solar array degradation for solar power that causes EOD larger changes. Battery degradation.
It's enough
time
for this.
Battery degradation is causing EOD to increase. Every key's battery is discharged below 6.2 volts during storage, which will cause any power calculations are kind of incorrect at the moment.
Do you mean temperature?
That's
yeah,
probably
yeah.
better.
Yeah.
See, look at that. Totally makes that for you. It's our preliminary even.
To solve these problems, so for A, we can use telemetry to monitor and adjust duty cycling, so to monitor voltage to dipping below 6.2. We could adjust power distribution and duty cycling to alleviate the effect of inflation. C, we could change conducts and reduce transmit. For D, we can ensure battery inhibits are in place until launch and activation. And E, use more complex and accurate calculations in conjunction with simulations and physical tests.
Do you have any concerns on operational temperature of the batteries? Like that in the temperature range and how that affects efficiencies?
The thermal is going to talk pretty sensitive.
So you guys can talk to the team about the operation range of the
injection. So is the battery the most sensitive thing, the thermal?